Hello, and welcome back to the Networking for AI Summit. I'm Bob Laliberte, Principal Analyst at theCUBE Research. And in this discussion, I'm joined by luminary Bob Friday, the Chief AI Officer at HPE Networking. Welcome, Bob.
Yep. Thank you for having me again, Bob. Great to be here.
That's two Bobs. We're going to try and keep this clear for everyone.
Bob squared.
All right, so in this session, we're going to explore the concept of self-driving networks, and we're going to draw parallels to self-driving cars, and then, you know, really look at the different stages of autonomy that enterprises can progress through. And our goal is to help you understand where the industry is today, what challenges need to be overcome, and how HPE Networking self-driving networks can help accelerate the adoption of AI at scale. All right, so let's get started. Bob, you've often used the analogy of self-driving cars when you wanted to explain self-driving networks. Can you just walk everyone through how the stages of automation in cars map to networking?
Yeah, you know, when you look at, you know, the self-driving Waymo Uber experience, we kind of saw the whole industry go through that same effort of, you know, how do we learn to trust, you know, when you get in that first Waymo Uber, you know, what made you decide you're going to trust that self-driving car to get you from A to B? And you kind of saw the whole industry go from lane changes, you know, we got comfortable with, yes, I trusted to keep me in the lanes, keep me in front of cars. And you got enough experience that that self-driving Waymo Uber, you finally made the decision that it is on par with a human driver. I think we're going through the same thing in the network industry. How do you learn to trust your AI assistants, you know, before you turn the keys over to your data plane?
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And a question for you would be, where do you think most IT professionals, networking professionals are today in that progression? Are they at just the lane assist? Are they starting to move into fully automated or somewhere in between?
Yeah, no. Now, interestingly, I would say, you know, 10 years ago when I started Mist, I would say everyone was a skeptic. Customers, investors, none of them believed, you know, like this AI stuff was still a research topic. Interestingly, I was with a bunch of probably 50 large customers in Europe last month. And we did the survey of like, where are you in the adoption of AI? 10 years ago, they were all skeptics. They didn't want to talk about it. Now they all realize that it's going to be relevant. They're either adopting it or they know it's going to be relevant to their business. They're not quite sure the difference between marketing AI and real AI. But, you know, after they've seen ChatGPT, they've seen self-driving Waymo, they know that AI is going to be relevant to their networking IT business.
Yeah, and I think that's a really important point that you bring up, because what I've always found is that anytime a technology gets consumerized, the adoption tends to accelerate in the enterprise, right? It's not like we're trying to push it down the enterprise side first. It's they've got to experience it. They've gotten a taste of it. So in this case, ChatGPT, like you said, those Waymo, that right, the self-driving cars and things like that. And they're understanding that, hey, there are benefits to this. So Bob, I'm hoping you could maybe share some of the practical benefits that organizations are realizing today as they move from one stage of the journey to the next.
Yeah, you know, I've talked to some higher ed IT departments and some retail IT departments. And I think one theme you hear, you know, from customers, enterprises that have moved from standard networking to this cloud AI ops model is that they've gone from being reactive to proactive. You know, if you talk to the average IT person when they walked in the morning, it used to be a very reactive job. There's always a new set of problems they were walking into. I think when you talk to customers who have actually made the leap from to cloud AI ops, you'll just hear that they don't have the same problems every day. They've gone to a more proactive, and they can focus on other things in their business now besides worrying about the latest IT network fire when they walk in.
Yeah, no, I think that makes sense, right? And organizations are starting to learn to trust these a little bit more as well. One of the things I wanted to touch upon is that, you know, similar to self-driving cars, right? They rely on sensors and a lot of data in order to navigate safely. Self-driving networks have to depend on the telemetry, the AI that's actually built into it, and automation. I'm wondering how HPE Networking brings all these elements together to enable those autonomous actions in the network.
Yeah, you know, this is an interesting one because, you know, I always tell, when Sujay and I started Mist, you know, we didn't build an access point because we thought the world needed another access point. We did it because we wanted to make sure we were going to get the right data to really be able to predict user experiences and solve that problem. You know, I think what we're seeing right now, the old adage, garbage in, garbage out, data is the gold for AI. You know, AI is nothing without data. Now, interestingly, when we move into these agentic AI, we're starting to see more data sources become available. You know, if you look what we're doing here at HPE Networking, we're actually putting, you know, minis and software agents into the network itself to bring more data back to the product. And we're starting to tap into MCP to tap into other data sources like Zoom and Teams. So I think that's what we're starting to see in the industry is data is king, and the more data you bring, the more problems with you can solve with more granularity.
Absolutely. You know, one of the concepts I've always looked at when I was thinking about AI is that time to comfort with the technology. You had mentioned that as well. How do you trust what's going on? Certainly with cars, people had to learn to like lane keeping, brake assist, things, maybe even backing up, things of that nature, parking. What do you think are the equivalent trust building steps that have to happen within networking, right? Because it's not like organizations are just going to say, oh, it's fully autonomous, just flip the switch and let everything go. Where do you see as those important steps, and how do you see organizations adopting it?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, right, when we first got our first self-driving cars, you know, first of all, we had cruise control, then we had lane assist, then we had driver assist, and you slowly got comfortable with each one of these additions to automation. Now on the IT side, you know, we're starting to see, you know, customers start to trust Marvis to start like changing the, unsticking the port. You know, if there's a stuck port on the switch, you trust Marvis now to unstick it. If you find a missing VLAN, you start to trust Marvis. So I think we're going through that same journey of where IT is starting to let Marvis and AI assistants do various things for them. And then eventually when they trust it, then they basically say, don't ask me anymore. And they put that action on the trust list. So I think we're on that journey. I think, you know, what I tell people now, we've been on that journey for about 10 years. I really see this agentic AI, this nonlinear, non-deterministic programming tool we have now, is really going to be the acceleration of the journey. You know, it is really going to accelerate us from driver assist to self-driving.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And it's interesting, like I said, I think a lot of times it's going to be a specific use case that gets automated. And again, not all of the functions as people get more comfortable with the technology. I'm wondering if there's anything specifically that HPE Networking is doing to help organizations have confidence in these AI-driven operations. I used to call it having a closed loop system in place for feedback. I think the more common term now is human in the loop. Is that something that you're also making sure you're embedding into the technology so that the operators, especially the senior operators who've had 20, 30 years of experience, are able to see some transparency in what's taking place and have that confidence in what it's coming back and telling them?
Yeah, so interestingly, you know, this spring in May, we actually just introduced Marvis Actions 2.0 to the world. And this is really what we're talking about, feedback, right? Is providing the IT team the ability to decide which actions they're gonna let Marvis, trust Marvis to do. And then we give them a full audit log of how often, once you let Marvis do it, how often did he actually apply that action, right? And so that's the beginnings of the feedback loop of, yes, you know, you've given Marvis the ability to fix something. Let's keep a record of that. I would say, interestingly, you know, in our case, you know, we've got this Zoom Teams model, which is really kind of the user experience. So you can actually see your user experience bad minutes go down. As Marvis starts to fix things, you can actually see an improvement directing on the user experience on the network. So that's the feedback loop of, yes, it is making a difference. It's making better user experience. And you can see exactly which actions Marvis is taking.
Yeah. And just out of curiosity, I'm also curious as to how it's always been my thought that having those really senior experienced network operators out there providing feedback into that loop is going to also be important. Does that benefit HPE Networking as well as you're building out your models and refining them?
I think it's going to be critical, actually. It's another interesting point of, hey, if you look where agentic AI, you can almost view it as a kind of nonlinear, non-deterministic programming language, right? So really the whole software QA process is changing as we move into this agentic age, right? Because we really need domain experts to give us feedback if we're making progress. you know, so we're built, whether I'm doing a troubleshooting CI use case or self-driving use case, I need domain experts, which is really my sales engineers, support team, customers, providing that feedback to make sure we're actually making things better, right? Are we actually improving the efficacy of Marvis?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's also an important thing to point out for all the network admins and network operators who are watching this. You're actually going to play a very active role in progressing this AI technology and ensuring that it operates the way it should. So again, nothing to fear, something you want to embrace. And the sooner you embrace it, the sooner you jump in, the more benefit you're going to get from it. I know from research that we've done, when we looked at organizations that have had AI operations employed for a longer period of time, more often than not, they're saying that the number one benefit they get is that they've got more time to work on strategic initiatives for the business and drive revenue and so forth, versus the ones who first get it initially are all saying, hey, this is great, I can find and fix problems faster. But the ones who've had it for a little bit longer really understand the true value is that they can now take that time that they've saved and put it towards helping to drive towards those business goals.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, if you look at anyway, I tell people, you look at these AI assistants, you have to treat them like a new employee. You know, if you look at automation in the past, it was very deterministic. We built automations and it did the same thing day in and out. These new AI assistants, they're more like a dynamic human, right? The more effort you put in to train it, the more feedback you get, the better this AI assistant is going to get. And that's probably the big change from what we've seen in the past with automation and what we're doing now with agentic AI and this new generation of automation.
Absolutely, absolutely. That sounds great. So we're running low on time, but I can't end this without asking you, what does the future look like? How do you see the industry starting to move forward from today's partially automated network as it goes to fully self-driving networks? And what's the role that you see that, you know, HPE Networking is going to play in that?
Yeah, you know, for me personally, I didn't think I would be live long enough to be in a self-driving Waymo Uber. You know, so we are there though in those days, right? It's almost like a sci-fi movie when you go to the Phoenix Airport and watch these self-driving cars. I think I am going to see the self-driving network vision come to life within my career right now. I think we're at this forefront or right at that step breaking point, tipping point of where agentic AI, we have the tools now to really start to make a self-driving network experience. And I think that's where HPE and Juniper coming together really has an opportunity to accelerate, you know, because we're bringing two market leaders together and we're getting all that data science muscle behind one vision, one mission. So yes, between agentic AI, HPE, Juniper, I think it's going to happen within my, before I retire.
Excellent. Well, I'm glad to hear that. And hopefully that's still a long ways off, because I know I've enjoyed following your career and all that you're bringing to it. So that's always much appreciated. And again, Bob, thank you so much for coming on. Thanks for sharing your perspectives on the journey to self-driving networks.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This topic dear to my heart. So always happy to chat.
Absolutely. So as we've heard, moving from manual operations to higher levels of autonomy is not just about technology. And it's also about building trust. It's about simplifying operations and preparing for the future of that AI infrastructure. For all the attendees, hope this session provided some clarity on the stages of self-driving networks and how you guys can enable more resilient, efficient, and scalable infrastructure in your environment. Stay tuned with us as we continue with the Networking for AI Summit.